The Triassic was a remarkable and yet often overlooked period in our Earth's history. Life, bouncing back from the most cataclysmic extinction event in geological history, was beginning to mould itself into an all manner of bizarre forms, the likes of which the planet had never seen before. One could, quite aptly I think, summarise the fauna of the Triassic as the vertebrates' attempt to reenact the Cambrian explosion. On land, oddballs and misfits of all shapes and sizes roamed, from prototype Spinosaurus to whatever the hell this thing is. Dinosaurs also saw their beginnings in the Triassic, but they were a far cry from the monumental titans of prehistory that they would one day become. So life on land was weird and probably more than a little bit scary. But if a certain childhood classic has taught me anything, it's that no matter how bad things get on land, the one thing you should never, ever do is get in the water. Just like the land, the oceans of the Triassic had been conquered by reptiles. And all manner of marine reptiles patrolled the seas, from elaborately armoured placodonts to fierce, toothy nodosaurs. But by far the biggest were the ichthyosaurs. Ichthyosaurs were among the greatest oceanic predators to have ever lived, and one group, the Shastasaurids, reached sizes that the more famous mosasaurs and pliosaurs could have never dreamed of approaching. One such member of the family, Shastasaurus sicaniensis, has long held the title of being the biggest marine reptile known to have ever existed. And with an estimated length of around 21 metres, and being known from relatively complete remains to boot, such a leviathan would seem exceedingly difficult to dethrone. But over the decades, mysterious bone fragments have been unearthed in Triassic sediments, and it's becoming increasingly likely that these tantalising pieces point to the existence of ichthyosaurs whose sheer enormity could have exceeded even that of Shastasaurus. In 2016, a large, isolated bone fragment was found in Lilstock in the United Kingdom, and subsequently described in a study that was published in 2018. Its condition was far from perfect, being incomplete and subjected to no small amount of wear. But hey, it's not like I could expect to look any better after 200 million years, so I'm not going to judge. In spite of its less than ideal state, it could still be identified as a lower jawbone known as the syrangula of a giant Shastasaurid ichthyosaur, based off structural parallels such as the presence of a well-defined Machelian groove that likened it to the corresponding bones of the more completely known Shonisaurus popularis and Shastasaurus sicaniensis. And scaling it to the proportions of the other large Shastasaurids indicates some truly immense sizes, ranging between 20 and 25 metres long. So, essentially, it's a consolation prize for all the people who, like my 10-year-old self, were heartbroken about the actual size of Liopleurodon. But the discovery of enigmatic remains hinting at the presence of colossal Triassic ichthyosaurs goes back considerably further than 2016. Decades earlier, multiple large, cylindrical bone sections were found at Oust Cliff, Gloucestershire. But their fragmentary state made their identity difficult to ascertain, and there were multiple competing hypotheses regarding what kind of animal they belonged to. Among the most prominent ideas was that these fossils represented the partial limb bones of sauropodomorph dinosaurs, though it was noted that the microstructure of the fossil was unusual for a dinosaur bone. But when compared to the Lilstock remains, the microstructure was a much closer fit. And that, combined with the fact that very large ichthyosaur vertebrae have been found in the same region, gives ample reason to suspect that, like the Lilstock fossil, the cylindrical fragments from Oust Cliff represent the partial jawbones of enormous ichthyosaurs. And that's not the end of it either. Much more recently, another study thoroughly examined the histology of various known and suspected remains of Shastasaurid ichthyosaurs, including both the Lilstock and Oustcliff specimens, and found striking parallels across the board. What's more is that this detailed analysis effectively put to bed any competing hypotheses concerning their affinity, with the microstructure of the fossils being inconsistent with any of the other animal groups that these bones had been proposed to have belonged to. But the story of the Lilstock monster does not end here. In fact, an exciting new chapter has just now been written. On the 28th of May, 2020, a young girl and her father found a large section of bone in close proximity to where the original Lilstock remains had been discovered, and proceeded to contact Dean Lomax, one of the authors of the publication detailing the first Lilstock serangula found in 2016. Upon subsequent investigation, additional pieces were found, with the final section of the bone being recovered in late 2022, over 2 years after the fossil's initial discovery. Yeah, I don't think I have the patience for that job, but props to those who do. The presence of a characteristic Machelian groove suggested that this fossil too represented the serangular bone of a giant ichthyosaur. Like the original remains, this new fossil consisted of several articulated fragments and was also somewhat damaged, showing signs of scavenging and abrasion, as well as direct evidence of encrusting organisms such as bivalves. But while still fragmentary, it was significantly better preserved than the 2016 specimen. In terms of overall shape, morphology, and stratigraphic age, it matched the original Lilstock remains, indicating it belonged to the same species. The complete serangula of the ichthyosaur is estimated to have been around 2 meters long, which is seriously impressive. Remember, we're talking about just one part of the lower jaw here, not even the whole jaw, let alone the skull, let alone the entire animal, for which the original estimates of 20 to 25 meters are still deemed plausible based off simple scaling. As for how overall massive the animal was, well, there's a good deal more grey area there, if only because Shastasaurids as a whole are known to have varied quite considerably in regards to bulk, with some genera, like Bisanosaurus, being quite slender, and others, such as Shonisaurus, looking like the punchline of one of Jimmy Carr's Your Mum jokes. And in the absence of additional fossils from other parts of the body, it's difficult to conclude where on the fit to fat ass scale the Lilstock giant could have sat. The morphology of these fossils was found to be distinct from that of any other known ichthyosaur serangulas. Their age, too, was a distinguishing factor, with both fossils dating to the very end of the Triassic, and around 13 million years after the youngest hitherto named Shastasaurids, Himalayasaurus tibetensis and Shastasaurus sicaniensis, lived. These disparities with known genera were deemed significant enough to warrant the erection of a new genus and species. And now, this giant ichthyosaur, having been known only by its nickname of Lilstock Monster since its discovery, finally has a proper name. Ichthyotitan severnensis. So, Ichthyotitan is now a thing, and even though its remains are highly fragmentary, we can be pretty confident that this ichthyosaur was a true leviathan of the prehistoric seas. And what's more is that the specimens found may not even represent fully grown individuals. Analyses of the fossil's histology revealed certain signs that may indicate that this already enormous animal was still growing at the time of its death. A certain type of tissue, known as the external fundamental system, forms when an animal's growth has slowed, and is thus regarded as an indicator that skeletal maturity has been reached. And it appears to have been absent in both Ichthyotitan specimens. In addition to the apparent lack of external fundamental system, other histological features, including the presence of primary bone, serve to provide additional evidence that the Ichthyotitan specimens may not have been skeletally mature. exactly how much bigger they could have gotten, well, we can only guess. But the mere possibility that such behemoths could have represented individuals that had yet to reach their maximum size is just awe-inspiring to think about. But what else can we infer about Ichthyotitan aside from just big and maybe even bigger? Namely, how could it have lived? Of course, there's only so much that can be said based off a couple isolated jaw fragments. But that doesn't mean we can't infer things based off our knowledge of other Shastasaurid ichthyosaurs. For a long time, the huge ichthyosaurs of the Triassic were thought to have been essentially gentle giants, vaguely analogous to many of the whale species alive today. But more recent findings have indicated that the giant Shastasaurids were rather more diverse in their lifestyles than initially thought, and that at least some were fearsome predators. Shonisaurus popularis was once believed to have only possessed teeth as juveniles, with adults being toothless suction feeders, but it was later found that the species had robust, sharp teeth at all life stages, indicating a more raptorial, macro-predatory lifestyle. Himalayasaurus tibetensis was, if anything, even more adapted for macro-predation, with a mouth full of large, cutting teeth. More recently, what is perhaps the biggest ichthyosaur tooth ever found was discovered in the Swiss Alps, once again dating to the Late Triassic. So while robust conclusions about the dietary preferences of Ichthyotitan severnensis are nigh impossible to arrive at due to the extremely fragmentary nature of the species' currently known remains, the ever-growing body of evidence pointing to giant Shastasaurids as a whole being more macro-predatory than previously assumed suggests that it is very possible that the animal could have been one of the most formidable hunters ever to patrol the seas. Well, that is about it for this video. If you'd like to learn more about the enormous ichthyosaurs of the Triassic, then feel free to check out this upload by one of my favourite paleontology channels. And unlike yours truly, he actually focuses on paleontology, as opposed to being a bug nerd who occasionally makes videos about other random shit he happens to find interesting. And speaking of random shit I happen to find interesting, here's a video about fungi for your perusal. So thank you all very much for watching, and I shall see you again very soon.